move to the final award of the evening, which is the Outstanding Contribution to Ireland Award. The Outstanding Contribution Award was launched by President Bill Clinton in 2010 with the objective of, quote, recognizing individuals who, through their efforts, either individually or in partnership with others, have made a unique and significant contribution to the island of Ireland in bettering the lives of people and communities, both present and future. And with that in mind, to reflect on this evening so far and to introduce tonight's worthy recipient, would you welcome once more, ladies and gentlemen, Ian Hyland.
Thanks so much, John. Can I ask some hush in the corner of the room? You're all very noisy over there. Hush, or I'll ask the schoolmaster to come back on stage again. Before I go forward, it is a very special evening this evening. I think we can feel that in the room, and with our honorees just come past and what we're about to do in the next couple of minutes. If I could just communicate a small Dublin story. Mary had mentioned to me what an energy it was in the room, and you know, it's great to be back in Dublin, and sometimes you miss the humor. And I was in a cab this morning coming in, and I was on the phone, and the cab driver overheard me talking about tonight with one of my colleagues, and he said, are you involved in the thing tonight? I heard in the radio, you know, about the convention center. And I said, what radio station? Obviously, Dennis, it was 98FM. But he said to me, no, it's a very big noise. He says, I heard Mary Robinson was going to be ordained, he says, in the convention center. Now, we've handed out some very important gongs in our time, but Mary, unfortunately, we can't stretch it that far this evening. Well, look, good evening again, everybody. And after all those wonderful words earlier on, I'll nick George Mitchell's line and tell you that I feel like Elizabeth Taylor's eighth husband on their wedding night. I know exactly now what to do, but I'd be damned if I know how to make it interesting. But I'll give it a go, okay? But can I start now by congratulating, first of all, as we come to the final part of the evening, both Microsoft and Intel for their really fitting recognition this evening. And indeed, our company of the year, Kerry Group and Stan and all the team, who now become the second company in history of the Business and Finance Awards over 41 years to receive this accolade twice. Many congratulations, Stan. It's a testament. It's a testament to their constant progress and indeed leadership of Stan McCarthy and his team. And many congratulations again. I also want to congratulate Tommy Breen and his much-deserved recognition tonight by his peers as the Business Person of the Year. Congratulations, Tommy. Tommy is one of Ireland's finest business leaders. And tonight, we are particularly delighted to present you with that award. Tommy, you do join a group which includes Michael Smurfit, Dennis O'Brien, Anne Herity last year, Danuta Gray, Tony O'Reilly, Tony Ryan, Jim O'Hara, Willie Walsh, and that's just to name a few. So you're in very, very good company. Tommy, many congratulations once again. Sean Murphy earlier noted that the Business and Finance Awards are vital in recognising the real achievers in Irish businesses. But in truth, we could not do this without the partnership of KPMG. And in particular, Sean Murphy and his entire team at KPMG. KPMG are synonymous with the legacy of this awards program, and I would like to thank them for their support and their partnership, as we have together recognized some of Ireland's most outstanding business, political, and indeed community leaders over what could arguably be the most defining decade in Ireland. Sean, thank you very much indeed. You might also oblige me by allowing me to express my gratitude to all of these here who have made tonight possible and our other patrons and sponsors. And I mentioned KPMG, Sean and his team, our patrons and sponsors, Air, Glow Health, Jaguar, people like Intel, Microsoft, and indeed the team at SAS, and all of our patrons who make tonight possible. I hope you agree it's a very special room this evening, and thank you for your support, maybe your appreciation. And to John Bowman for a truly outstanding job, and for being, as always, a pillar of professionalism. John Bowman. And if I can for a moment thank my own colleagues in our own business and everyone connected with business and finance across our company. And I'm not going to mention anybody in particular this evening because I get into trouble, but I want to thank all of the guys. They're an outstanding group of people. They work long hours and they've traveled the world this year. But to put this event on is just a monumental challenge, and I've done it yet again. Many congratulations, guys. You should be very proud. Early this evening, John referenced the fantastic work of Haven and the incredible work they are doing in Haiti. And tonight, we are fortunate to be joined by a number of organizations who work every day to effect change and tackle some of the most pressing issues facing society. I'd like to mention the Ireland Funds. Kieran McLaughlin, CEO of the Worldwide Ireland Funds, has joined us from New York this evening. Ronan Foley, their Irish chairman. And for harnessing the generosity of Ireland's global diaspora that Mary Robinson so frequently speaks about. UNICEF, I mentioned Paul Connolly, Peter Power, and the team at UNICEF, the work is quite simply outstanding. And a range of not-for-profits and charities like Lessons for Life, Concern, Goal, and the Chernobyl Children's International. And A.D. Roach is here with us this evening, who's done quite amazing work all over the world. Very, very, congratulations to all of you. In reflecting on our roles and responsibility as a business community in this regard, the Irish proverb comes to mind, "In yart go cur le céile." We are stronger working together. Mary Robinson often speaks of the concept of mehel, an Irish word that describes a traditional rural practice of people coming together to support one another as certain needs arise. It expresses the idea of community spirit and self-reliance, and in the same ethos, I believe that we, as a business people, have a critical role to play in supporting our surrounding communities in a spirit of progress and partnership. It is with this in mind tonight that I'm delighted to announce the establishment of the Elevation Foundation. The goal of the Elevation Foundation is to partner with business and create opportunities for further generations to shape and impact the change they want to see. In this regard, our core aim will be to assist young people who are committed to innovation and social enterprise to reach their full potential and to offer the financial and practical assistance necessary to achieve this. Tonight, in the spirit of looking to the future, I am delighted to announce our first key initiative in launching the Elevation Scholarship Program. In launching the Elevation Scholarship this evening, the Elevation Foundation is affirming its commitment that regardless of background, circumstance, creed, or culture, every young person deserves an opportunity to succeed. To achieve this, we are proud to be partnering with Breen McCraw and Dublin City University to provide educational and practical funding for students who have illustrated a commitment to changing the world around them through their services to others or their passion for enterprise and innovation. I want to thank Breen McCraw and DCU for his partnership, and we look forward to working with him. And many congratulations to DCU, indeed all of the universities here this evening, for the great work they're doing in educating our next generation. And so, as we invest in the leaders of tomorrow, we now move to honoring a leader of today with the Outstanding Contribution to Ireland Award. As John mentioned, this award was launched by President Clinton here in Dublin in 2010 with the objective of recognizing individuals who through their efforts, either individually or in partnership with others, have made a significant contribution to the island of Ireland in bettering the lives of people and communities through their actions. In recent years, we have honored some truly outstanding individuals, including Senator George Mitchell, and last year in this room, John Major, and posthumously, Albert Reynolds. Tonight, we continue this tradition by recognising a woman who has a transformative impact on Ireland and indeed on the world. Growing up, Mary Robinson was the only female in a family of four brothers, watching her father, Aubrey, a doctor in rural Ireland, caring for the poorest individuals in their community. For Mary, this would shape the backbone of her core values and a moral compass that would guide her on a journey as an activist, a president, and a global leader. Many of us here in the room will be familiar with the now iconic light that Mary Robinson placed in the window of the kitchen in Áras an Uachtaráin, a tradition her mother Tessa started in their family home as a symbol of hospitality to strangers. While the light in the Áras was a beacon of hope and hospitality for exiles and immigrants, it symbolizes so much more. In recognizing Mary Robinson this evening, we reflect on a woman who shone a light into the darkest injustices and inequalities both here in Ireland and across the globe. In doing so, she empowered a generation to emerge from the shadows of darkness and realize the potential of a brighter future. As a lawyer at Harvard Law School in the late 1960s, Mary Robinson developed a deep moral authority in an environment that questioned the ethics of war in Vietnam and the injustice of racism in America's South. Close to home, however, Ireland shone as a microcosm of the change she longed to see. With dignity and perseverance, and in the face of unprecedented obstruction, she awoke Ireland's social conscience. From critical issues such as family planning, the role of women, and gay rights, her leadership did not just change laws, it changed behaviors. A victory for Mary Robinson and her friend, Senator David Norris, at the European Court of Human Rights in 1998 began a national conversation on the true meaning of equality. It was to be a significant step on a journey of small increments towards becoming a nation of equals. This journey reaches final point, justice, at Dublin Castle earlier this year. And Mary Robinson's role in starting this conversation and so many others of vital importance can never be underestimated. It was Mary Robinson and Kofi Annan's elders colleague Nelson Mandela, while speaking of courage, said, "Courage is not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it." As an Irish community, we can certainly agree that this is a story of Mary Robinson's presidency. As a voice for women, who Evan Boland described as outside history, and in changing the role of women in Irish society, Mary Robinson transcended traditional boundaries and moved into history. However, one person not to immediately thank Mary for changing societal norms was actually her driver, who on returning home one evening during Mary's term asked his wife to pour him some tea, only to be told to make your own tea, things have changed around here. In becoming the first serving Irish president to visit the United Kingdom and meet Queen Elizabeth II at Buckingham Palace, Mary Robinson laid strong foundations for sustainable peace on this island. Internationally, Mary Robinson embodied an ethos of not just doing things right, but doing the right things. In Somalia and Rwanda, she highlighted the gross poverty that was destroying lives of millions, acting as a custodian of the rights of those who simply had no voice. At a global level, Mary Robinson transformed the way we view human rights and the importance we place on this by grasping Seamus Heaney's personal advice and taking hold of her post as UN High Commissioner boldly and duly. Over her term as President and indeed as UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, Mary Robinson illustrated immense political courage in everything she did. As a result, Ireland and the world is a different place today. Ireland and the world is a better place today.
To have quite a short technical legal bill which will repeal section 17 of the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1935, which makes it a crime to sell or have for sale or advertise contraceptives.
I was elected by men and women of all parties and none, by many with great moral courage who stepped out from the faded flags of the Civil War and voted for a new Ireland, and above all, by the women of Ireland.
And I'm sorry that I cannot be entirely calm speaking to you, because I have such a sense of what the world must take responsibility for.
I mentioned earlier my role in the Secretary General's plan to integrate human rights in all aspects of the United Nations work.
The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, I carry it around with me, and it has a wonderful beginning in Article 1. It just says, quite simply, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights.
I have to conclude that there must have been some reason why President Milosevic did not wish to meet me, because I certainly wish to meet him.
I've never been able to get Somalia out of my skin, if you like. Since I was here in 1992. And when I look around and I see yet again, and these are very resilient people, and they want the best, they want just food and water initially for their families.
More small islands will go under, more communities will be flooded, big cities will be flooded, and we obviously don't want that.
I mean, it really is an unjust impact, and it's impacting on their right to food, on their health, on their shelter. It's displacing them, and it's really a human rights issue, very fundamentally.
I'm very proud of my Irishness. It was the greatest honour that anybody could have to serve as President of Ireland.
When she travelled abroad as President, she would place a light in her window that would draw people of Irish descent to pass by below. Today, as an advocate for the hungry and the hunted, the forgotten and the ignored, Mary Robinson has not only shone a light on human suffering, but illuminated a better future for our world.
She cares about poverty, she cares about injustice, she cares about oppression. She has an incredible warmth. She's got a way of disarming people.
Mary has embodied the issue of human rights and respect to the other. Now it has become a part of herself.
Now, Mary, I have a feeling you're going to get more than one ovation tonight. What outstanding inspiration and somebody who makes us very proud to be Irish, Mary. Ladies and gentlemen, Mary Robinson is a woman who lit a light in her home, a light in the hearts of millions in Ireland and around the world, and a woman who has lit a torch of vision, equality and justice, which other generations will now carry forward. As an indication of the esteem that Mary is held across the globe, ladies and gentlemen, I'm incredibly honored to now welcome to the stage and formally introduce our honoree. Can you please welcome former UN Secretary General and High Commissioner for Refugees, Mr. Kofi Annan.
Thank you very much. Let me say that I was the Secretary General of the UN, but not the High Commissioner for the Refugees. I worked there, but in a lower position during the years of the Vietnamese boat people. Tonight, having heard all the comments here, let me assure you, when my wife, Nan, and I were heading this way, we could feel the vitality in the city and the sense that Ireland and Dublin is coming back. The traffic was so heavy that at one point I had the feeling we will not make it to the Dyson. Ladies and gentlemen, let me thank you and say how pleased my wife and I are that you've asked us to join you for tonight's celebrations. And let me first convey my sincere congratulations to the recipients of the awards already presented, and to say that it is really wonderful for us to be here to join you as you honor these people, and for me to also meet and applaud my old friend Mary. Your achievements leave little doubt about what the private sector can do, the positive force it can be, and the fact that doing good is also good for business. Business has a crucial role to play in the global challenges that we face. And that was one of the reasons why I launched the Global Compact in 1999, where many companies in this room, I'm sure, have signed on to. I applaud your desire and redefine what we mean by business as usual, and encourage you to keep up these efforts as we move into the future. Mr. Hyland has left us with little doubt as to the impact of Mary Robinson and the impact she has had here in Ireland. And there are no question that she is worthy recipient of the outstanding contribution to the Ireland Award. However, it would be remiss of us not to acknowledge that Mary has also made an outstanding contribution on the world at large. And I think you did refer to that. Many might feel that her work as a social activist and a lawyer and as elected senator and president of Ireland would be adequate for one person's lifetime. Yet the same passion for justice and the desire to protect the rights of the most vulnerable in society led Mary to a second equally impressive career on the international stage. She was one of the most effective High Commissioners for Human Rights to ever hold the office, and I was ever grateful that she accepted my request to assume that role. As Special Envoy for the Great Regions, the Great Lakes Regions, she has an impassioned voice for peace in one of the most violent corners of our world. And in both roles, she embodied the values at the heart of the United Nations: justice and tolerance, advocacy for those who have no voice, and an unwavering dedication to the notion that there is more that binds us together than pulls us apart. And still, Mary was not finished. As a fellow member of the Elders, I know that her commitment to tackling critical issues has not wavered. She has become a fierce advocate for the ending of child marriage and has protected and empowered vulnerable girls in communities across the globe. As you all know, through her foundation here in Dublin, she is one of the leading voices for concerted action on climate change. And if that wasn't enough, the Secretary General Ban Ki-moon appointed her as Special Envoy for Climate Change. And she just came from Paris, where we've had a major success. This critical challenge requires leadership of the highest caliber, and I know you will join me in encouraging Mary to continue her work despite the agreement in Paris. Paris is the beginning. We now have to push for implementation, and each and every one of us has a role to play. This is not something we leave to governments, to corporations. We as individuals have a role to play. There is an African proverb which says, the earth is not ours, it's something we hold in trust for future generations, our children and grandchildren. Let us be worthy of that trust. However, more than any job she has held, it is the quality of her character and the depth of her commitment that are worthy of recognition tonight. In 2011, Mary and I traveled to the Ivory Coast to bring a message of peace and reconciliation amidst the upheaval that followed their violent presidential elections. We held a series of meetings with government officials, the media, civil society, including delegation and representatives of women's groups. I will not forget that meeting. Those women were truly desperate, watching firsthand as their country slid closer towards an all-out civil war. They did not know Mary, and I suspect many understood little of her past achievements or position. But they immediately understood the sincerity of her concern and compassion, and her determination to act was unmistakable. It is the same for all those whom Mary has fought for over the course of her extraordinary long career. And so, ladies and gentlemen, as you have thanked Mary for her contribution to the people and politics of Ireland, allow me also to convey my sincere thanks to her for outstanding service to our international community and for being my friend and colleague over many years. Nan and I have always treasured our association and friendship with Mary and Nick. And let me ask you to join me and raise your glasses for our very special guest of honor, Mary Robinson. I don't have a glass, but imagine a glass. Imagine a glass, and let's toast. And let me conclude. Thank you. So let's toast to Mary. To Mary. And let me conclude by saying, Gurev Mil Mahagot Acadia. Good.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please remain upstanding for the outstanding contribution to Ireland honoree, Mary Robinson.
What an evening. And I must say I'm very impressed with the spirit of this evening. There's a lovely undertone of something about giving to others, something about thinking about others, that has really been threaded through this evening. And it was captured in the Elevation Foundation and the scholarship program. But it's really been there all evening, and I really appreciate that. I'd like to thank Ian Hyland very much for his very warm words. It's almost hard to listen to something like that because you know the downside of yourself, you know, and it's difficult. But I also would particularly like to thank both Coffee and Nan for coming to Ireland, and then Coffee for basically speaking so warmly and presenting me with this award tonight. You know that Kofi Annan used to be my boss, and he's still, in a sense, my boss because he's chair of the elders that I belong to, so he can call me to a halt and turn off the mic or something if I'm being noisy, you know. I'm truly honored to receive this award from Business and Finance tonight, and I really do so with quite a sense of humility because I'm only one of so many who work so hard for the respect and the protection and the promotion of human rights around the world, sometimes at the risk of their lives. And sometimes when I visit places, I feel I'm visiting, but they're staying, they're there, and they are true heroes. As you know, I've just returned from Paris, where I witnessed the start of a quiet, peaceful revolution, the triumph of humanity over self-interest. In Paris, where the rights of man and of citizen was declared in 1789, where the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was signed in 1948, and the Paris Agreement was declared on the 12th of December 2015, which is truly an agreement for humanity. It was interesting that most of the leaders of small island developing states, some of which could go under if sea level rises, the leaders of least developed countries, the leaders of countries like the Philippines and Bangladesh, which suffer so much, were really rejoicing at the end of the meeting. And I thought, that is good. It's not a perfect agreement, but the fact that they're rejoicing lifts my heart. The Paris Agreement deals with how we, as a global community, are going to tackle climate change. It was adopted by 195 countries under the able stewardship of the French government. And it provides the opportunity to transform our way of life to one that is fairer and more sustainable, one that doesn't depend on polluting fossil fuels, but on clean, renewable energy. Now, as a former president, Uachtaráin, I shall refrain, of course, from commenting on our own white paper just published. I come back to the Paris Agreement, which establishes the need to keep global temperature rise, and I quote, well below 2 degrees, and I quote again, and to pursue efforts to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius. That is significant. We haven't heard it quite like that before. It demonstrates that 195 countries accept the need to leave nobody behind in our transition to renewable energy, given that at 2 degrees warming above pre-industrial levels, many people and some countries would not survive. Those of us living and working throughout the developed world take access to electricity for granted. I think we forget, or perhaps we've never known, the drudgery that access to energy removes from daily life. But today, 1.3 billion people in our world are still living in energy poverty. For me, this is an intolerable failure of human solidarity. Energy is the engine of development. It brings life, transforming benefits. It brings lighting for schools, functioning health clinics, pumps for water and sanitation, cleaner indoor air due to decrease in cooking on open fires, and greater income-generating opportunities. It's imperative that all people have access to productive energy. And yet, our traditional means of generating energy, so heavily dependent on the burning of fossil fuels, is driving us to the brink of a global catastrophe. Climate change requires us to fundamentally rethink how we power our societies. Our tried and tested development paradigm is totally unsustainable. According to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, average global surface temperatures have already risen by as much as 0.8 degrees Celsius since the late 19th century. And as you probably know, the UK Met Office has predicted that warming will reach 1 degree Celsius by the end of 2015, by the end of this year, halfway to danger, and we want to get to 1.5. It's because of the unfair impacts of climate change on people that I've taken on the struggle of climate justice, and it's a concept that I share with Kofi Annan. When I worked with him on his Global Humanitarian Forum, we first talked about climate justice. Climate justice links human rights and development to achieve a people-centered approach, safeguarding the rights of the most vulnerable and sharing the burdens but also the benefits of climate change and its resolution equitably and fairly. In essence, climate justice demands that the global community come together to solve two interdependent challenges. We must enable development for all people while bringing global carbon emissions down to zero, ideally by 2050. You, the business community here in Ireland, are part of that global community, so I want to share these challenges with you. Energy is at the heart of the solution to both of these challenges. The overriding priority for developing countries is development, and development requires energy. If affordable, sustainable alternatives aren't available, developing countries will turn to fossil fuels as the only option available to them, and who could blame them? They need to lift their people out of poverty, to improve public services and power their economies, just as the developed world has done. In order to realize universal access to sustainable energy by 2030, the timeframe under the Sustainable Development Agenda, the global community must understand the barriers to energy access for the poorest and most marginalized people. Tackling energy access isn't simply about the ambitious expansion of electricity capacity. Countries must pioneer innovative solutions that deliver energy services to poor people, for example, through decentralized mini-grids. As opportunities arise in this transition to sustainable development, it's imperative that investors and businesses respect human rights in their investments, operations, and supply. This applies to the provision of energy services too. To ensure that the transition to zero carbon bolsters human rights rather than undermining them, business activity should abide by the UN guiding principles on business and human rights. And it was Kofi Annan who gave the lead on Professor John Ruggie steering those UN guiding principles on business and human rights. In the years leading up to the Paris Agreement, more and more people, businesses, and civil society organizations have engaged with the climate agenda, and that's why it's been a good process. An issue of development, justice, human rights, and security. The reference to climate justice in the preamble of the agreement is evidence that the calls of people through marches, like the march in New York last year of 400,000 people that I took part in, petitions, online campaigns, music, and the arts have been heard. We need to keep building this momentum between now and 2020 to translate the agreement into ambitious actions both at the national and local level. Despite their differences, 195 countries came together to prove that a multilateral process built on trust and dialogue and that respects the capacity of smaller delegations to engage can yield strong results. However, there's obviously a lot of detail to be worked out and quickly. And I want to come back to Paris in conclusion. As I mentioned at the start of my speech, Paris has been the site of many globally significant events. In 1878, Paris hosted the first international exposition of electricity, as part of the World Fair hosted in the city that year. New technology, like the telephone, the dynamo, and the phonograph were on display. However, the star of the show was undoubtedly Thomas Edison, in Paris to exhibit his electric light bulb. Electric lighting has been installed all along the Avenue de l'Opera and the Place de l'Opera. When the switch was flipped, electric lighting flooded the streets, and France stepped into the age of electric energy. Also, at that World Fair in 1878, was Augustin Michaud, who unveiled a solar-powered engine. He won a gold medal for his efforts. But with coal in the ascendancy and no awareness of the environmental harms associated with burning fossil fuels, the French government deemed solar energy to be uncompetitive, uneconomical, and cut Michaud's funding. How different things might have been if they knew then what we know now. And you see, that's the key point. We now do know unequivocally that our fossil fuel dependent development and consumption patterns are damaging the planet. And we know that energy is the key to development. We should realize that it's in our self-interest to ensure that when the light is switched on by the 1.3 billion people who currently have no light, that it's powered by clean energy. The children of today will live with the consequences of the decisions we take or fail to take to implement this Paris Agreement. I hope that all of you here this evening, with the capacity to invest, to innovate, and to influence, will join our climate justice revolution, our quiet movement, and be on the right side of history. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mary Robinson. If I could just hold, you can stay standing if you like, if I could just hold both Mr. Annan and Mary Robinson stage just for a moment, I want to say thanks again to Mr. Annan and his wife Nan for traveling this evening, making this evening so special. I think we all agree, we've had some very nice occasions, but this is particularly special on so many different levels. And to see two global champions of equality and justice standing together in Dublin. What does that say about this country? So before I allow both Mary Robinson, who needs to leave quite soon to get to a very important interview, and Mr. Annan leave the stage. Mr. Annan, I thought it would be remiss of us to let you leave Ireland without a memento of the special occasion. So, and I hope they're close by, my daughter Lucy is here somewhere, and here she is here, and she's gonna give you a special gift on my behalf. It is a one-off edition of Seamus Heaney's poem, The Republic of Conscience, which was written in response to a request by Amnesty International, and I thought for yourself, Mr. Annan, and your wife Nan, I thought it would be most appropriate. Ladies and gentlemen, Kofi Annan and Mary Robinson. Now, as we move to conclusion, I think that's very special. I think we all agree, it's just fantastic. That poem, by the way, is illustrated by John Bean, but most uniquely, it's actually signed by Seamus, and I think it's indeed a blessing in his own right on so many different levels. And hopefully, Mr. Annan, you'll find a nice place in your desk in Geneva, and thank you so much for joining us. Finally, can I ask you just to hold for one moment? Our special honoree... Headmaster standing beside me. Our special honoree, Mary Robinson, holds a very dear place in the heart of the world, but particularly in the heart of the Irish people. And Mary, I think that reception tonight, without one, but two, but three ovations, is testament to the way that you have inspired so many people in this room and the next generation. They're here, and it's just fantastic to see people's reaction. And I know we all recognize what you've done on a global level. So I know I speak on behalf of all of us in thanking you for what you have done for Ireland and wishing you continued success in your endeavors. Importantly, before I make one final presentation to you, I want to congratulate Mary and Nick, who celebrated 45 years together last week. And by the way, when I congratulated Nick in the lift, he said it only feels like 44 and a half. I earlier referenced Evan Boland's poem, Outside History, with regard to how Mary's incredible achievements made her and so many other women part of history. I know that Evan has been a friend and a work, a source of inspiration for Mary from the days at Trinity College Dublin, right through to your inauguration, Mary, as president, and indeed beyond. So to conclude this very special evening, we could not think a more fitting gift to you than the gift of poetry itself. And with that, we are truly honored that Evan Boland is with us this evening, and we're going to come to the stage in a second to read her beautiful poem, The Singers, in honor of Mary Robinson. From myself, ladies and gentlemen, can I wish you all a very pleasant and peaceful Christmas, and I can ask you now to welcome to the stage Evan Boland.
I just want to say how immensely honored I am to be here on a wonderful evening. And, you know, the poem, The Singers, I chose to read this evening, and I want to thank Ian so much for asking me to do so. But The Singers was the poem Mary quoted from in her inauguration. And for me, it gives me the chance, among the many tributes this evening, to pay tribute to what I know as her friend has been one of her huge, persistent values since we were students, and that is her immense belief in the human imagination, and the dignity of people's ability to find their lives in language, which underlies so many human rights. The Singers infers simply the power and the strength of women when they come together. The women who were singers in the West lived on an unforgiving coast. I want to ask, was there ever one moment when all of it relented, when rain and ocean and their own sense of home was revealed to them as one and the same? After which every day was still shaped by weather, but every night their mouths filled with Atlantic storms and clouded over stars and exhausted birds. And only when the danger was plain in the music could you know their true measure of rejoicing in finding a voice where they found a vision. Thank you.
So that happily concludes, thank you very much, Ivan, that happily concludes tonight's speeches. Dessert still awaits for those of us who will be here. But it reminds me, Mary Robinson's remarks crystallized the importance of the role of the business community. It was a very political speech, and I hope you all heard it, because it was meant for you. And my advice to you is, on the day of general judgment, if there is such, if you can see Mary Robinson, just keep close and go through the same door. because I'd say there's a very special, St. Peter is probably keeping a very special place for her, because she certainly ticks all the boxes on the parable of the talents. I had the privilege of interviewing Mary for 4 hours. It actually took a bit longer than that, but it was a 4-hour broadcast, which I think there is no equivalent in Irish radio history, I think, that any politician would be worthy of 4 hours, but Mary was. So I know quite a bit about Mary, and I thought she was going to mention Paris. I thought she was going to mention the young woman from Ballina who, at the age of 17 or 18, went to Paris and discovered a sort of, how are they going to keep them down in Ballina now that they've seen Paris, sort of moment for her. And it's in her autobiography as well. But she is hugely indebted to her 4 brothers, I think, and to most of the men in her life, because basically Mary doesn't see the glass ceiling, and that's why she goes through it so easily. I'm not saying it isn't there, but there's a lesson there, I think, to be gender blind and just to proceed. And she did that also with the presidency. It was and I also want to commend her for choosing an absolutely stunning, any of you who are in media communications, press relations, advertising will know the point I'm making, for choosing a stunning title for her foundation. Climate Justice is 4 syllables. Climate Justice. And in those 2 words, the mission statement, with all of what's happening in Paris and all of that detail, can be captured in just those 4 syllables. And that's a lucky thing as well, that the words are there, and I'd say they translate pretty well into most languages. I'm not sure of that, but I'd say they probably do, and therefore it's a very happy choice for her foundation, and I wish her all the best with it, as we have. And I'll finish with a very small story, which I remember from her election as president, which is only 25 years ago, and it's all of 25 years ago. It's exactly 25 years ago, in 1990. And there was a time when people were not allowed to lobby as you went in to vote in Ireland. And it was quite a good innovation, because people were being ambushed as they went in to vote. And so the lobbyists had to be at least 100 meters, I think, from the polling station, wherever it was. And there was Mary was running as an independent, but promoted by the Labour Party. And she was giving the opportunity for a lot of people in a lot of constituencies for the first time in their lives to vote for a woman, and to vote, for that matter, for a left-wing candidate. Many of them had never really had much of that opportunity. But there was a particular feminist woman who was married to a Fianna Fáil councillor in Donegal, and she was considered a little bit suspect by some of her women colleagues, because she was pretty feisty. And as she went into the polling booth, one of them risked saying to her, "You'll do the right thing, Mary." And she turned around at the top of her voice, "I will," she said, "I'm voting Robinson." So that may have accounted for some further votes in those who heretically in the Fianna Fáil wing of the feminist movement voted for Robinson on that occasion. So anyway, I just share that with you. And a final point, which I remember from the broadcast, is Mary, and again, it's a small point, but a big point. When Mary Robinson met challenges, and she met many of them, and she met, I suppose, the glass ceiling, and she met the begrudgers, but when she first appeared as a very young barrister in the courts, and when she went into the law library the following week, there was a little notice on the pin board which said, "Women barristers do not wear trousers." And she took out her pen and she wrote, "Some women barristers do not wear trousers." So I would like to end there to thank you I was going to say such a wonderful audience, because you have been that, but truthfully, it was Kofi Annan who first ever silenced this room. You couldn't hear a pin drop, and this room, because of its extraordinary architecture, and it is very big, and it has to have many different functions and so on, and a lot of pillars around, the very, very great numbers of people, and people are meeting around for the first time, and meeting not since last year and so on, so you do get a murmur And you get that schoolteacher thing of talking in class. I now know what teachers mean when they get angry about that sort of small point. But anyway, Kofi Annan silenced the room. I'd like to thank Business and Finance and KPMG and all of the staff for the dinner and the wines and the backroom staff and you also for being such a wonderful audience. Thank you very much.